Thank you. All right, so I am here to talk to you about USDA's Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food initiative, which I was asked by Secretary Vilsack, former governor of Iowa, and presidential candidate, actually, early on in the last race, to spearhead when I came to USDA. He knew I had a lot of interest in organic and local foods and small and mid-sized farms, and so it's been a real treat to lead this effort. The bad news about coming here and talking about this is I am really at the heart of a lot of the local food movement, and I'm really speaking to many, many experts in the audience, so you guys are going to keep me very nervous. All right, so I want to start with a disclaimer. People kind of go crazy in this local food thing, and that's fine if they want to, but I'm not an advocate of just going crazy. I will admit to sometimes on New Year's wanting some raspberries. They're not local. My husband drinks a lot of coffee. It's not local. But it is about doing what we can. And so I think there are great opportunities to invest in local and regional. And let me just say that local is hot. I have a lot of friends who are in the retail business, and they say they haven't seen a food trend like local in their entire careers. And this is the chef survey. This is the second year of when we see their top trends. Locally sourced meats and seafood, number one. Two, locally grown produce. Three, sustainability. Four, nutritionally balanced children's dishes. And five, hyper-local, restaurant gardens, do your own butchering. The year prior, it was pretty much the same, except on that top five list were those little desserts, those mini desserts. I love those. I don't know why, what's happening to them. I hope they stay hot, because my own. So I started this Know Your Farmer initiative, announcing it on this young couple's farm. They're in Virginia. They were leasing land, and they were trying to produce local food to sell into the Metro DC market, knowing that they were going to do well financially. The good news about this initiative is now this young couple, using the Farm Service Agency's loan portfolio, got money from USDA to start and own their own farm, and they are doing it. And actually, I have my FSA executive director here. You kind of got a front row seat, didn't you, Dick? Dick Burt here. So if anyone is interested in what the FSA portfolio programs are that can help people engage in farming, please see him. I'm a political appointee. Had to be confirmed by the Senate, started April of 2009. And I'm very cognizant that the sand is running through the hourglass for me. We don't know what happens in the next election, and even if the president wins, I don't know if I'm up to it, whether he'd still want me to be at it. I have 4 years. And so I said, okay, you could think about all these great ideas in local, regional, and try to get Congress to pass legislation. They pass legislation, that takes some time, and then they have to fund it, and they pass another bill to fund it, and then you have to write the rules to implement it. And I said, you know what, I'm just going to look at the existing portfolio of programs, that we have at USDA and figure out how to make them work better for local regional. Here's an example. I came to USDA, and we have this program called in our Rural Development Portfolio, and Jay Healy is our Executive Director for Rural Development. He's a couple seats in there. You can grab him later on, too. We have this program called the Business and Industry Loan Guarantee Program. And Congress, in the 2008 Farm Bill, put a 5% set-aside for local and regional in this pile of money. And when I started going around the country asking people, what have you done with local and regional, many of our rural development specialists across the country weren't even aware that that was an opportunity for them. They weren't even aware that Congress had put that set-aside. So here's an example of a program that had a specific statutory mandate, and USDA wasn't really pushing it. They weren't really implementing it. So again, using existing programs. Another part of the Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food initiative, and why I've gone to a lot of college campuses to talk about agriculture, is that we're trying to spearhead a national conversation about food, where it comes from and who produces it. With less than 1% of Americans now directly connected to the farm or ranch, the literacy around agricultural production is really at an all-time low. And this makes it very, very difficult when you're trying to promote policies around agriculture if you're starting from scratch. And one of the things I say in college audiences is there's not a day goes by when you can't pick up the newspaper where you don't see very important issues connected to agriculture, whether it has to do with global climate change, labor unrest, a lot of the stuff that's going on in the Horn of Africa in terms of hunger, whether it has to do with rural communities sort of evaporating from our site, you name it, agriculture is at the center of it. USDA, by the way, is the fifth largest employer in the federal government. A lot of people are surprised by that. We're trying to do some new things in this administration. I'm really interested in perennialism. I don't think we've done enough research in perennialism. And this is actually a poster of some roots looking at an annual winter wheat versus a hybrid perennial wheat, the perennial, of course, being the one to your left, where you get a very, very deep root going down. The Land Institute in Kansas has done a lot of interesting research around perennialism. And how can we capture that as we go forward, and particularly when you have terrible droughts as we've had in some parts of this country? What can perennialism do to contribute to our survival? We've also had in this administration a lot of difficult conversations around coexistence. This is the term that we use. How do we get the organic guys, the people who are producing for a non-organic but non-GE genetic engineering market, and those who are using biotechnology, how do we find ways that all those production regimes can work and not step on each other's toes? Not an easy one. We also have a lot of issues that we're dealing with right now about how our Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, formerly known as food stamps, the SNAP program, what should we be using those dollars for? And you may have seen some information about the New York state asking for banning soda and junk food in the SNAP program. I'm just throwing out all these issues because we can talk about them. It's interesting. Food versus fuel. This is another hot topic you see in the paper. Our livestock producers around here, not so much around here, but more in other parts of the country, are they paying more for their feed because of the competition for ethanol? Big issue that people talk about. The next farm bill. Every 5 years, Congress writes a farm bill. The last one was 2008. People normally this time of year would be dressed up, rocking and rolling, writing a farm bill. It's been kind of uneven. There's not a lot of stuff out there. And all of a sudden, with this new deliberation about the debt ceiling, they're trying to wrap up a farm bill in the next 2 or 3 weeks. Kind of back of the envelope craziness. But you're going to be reading a lot about that in the newspaper. And we also talk a lot about environmental sustainability. Now, this is something that this part of the world has been talking about a long time. But the challenges never go away. They seem to just get to be greater. And one of the things that we're really looking at that might be really great for small and mid-sized as well as large-sized farms is eco-service markets, where you actually get paid as a farmer or rancher for the environmental services that you're providing to the general public, because you're keeping your lands in a conservation ethic that actually contributes to our good lifestyle. Coming in, I saw some friends from the orchard here saying they use a hip hoop house. These are hoop houses. Some parts of the country they call them high tunnels. When the chief of our Natural Resources Conservation Service came in to talk to me about a great idea he had around high tunnels, I had absolutely no idea what he was talking about. Then he showed me a photograph. I said, it's a hoop house. Where I come from, they call them hoop houses, chief. So anyhow, there's a real regional divide apparently in the vocabulary here. But one of the things that we're trying to do new things with our money within those existing programs. We have a program called the Environmental Qualities Incentive Program, EQIP. Cost shares with farmers, number of practices. And we put a new practice in. It was to cost share these hoop houses. We offered it up on a pilot basis in 43 states, and we had phenomenal uptake. I remember when it was first offered, someone said, a reporter said, oh, it's just, you know, that deputy, it's some New England thing. Hey. The state that took the biggest advantage of it was Wisconsin. It was wildly popular across the country, even in Alaska. It's a way that farmers can extend the growing season and also combat pests and deal with nutrient runoff. We spent about $13 million last year on this initiative. It's a drop in the bucket, but it's also the camel's nose under the tent. So some of you have eye clickers. We have some more, I think, if you need them. I'm going to play a little game with you here. If you've ever seen that show, Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader? Yep, then we're going to do that. So I want to find out what you know about agriculture. And again, I know you're a very savvy crowd, But let me see if I can catch you. First question, what percentage of the continental United States is in private land ownership? All right. Let's see what you have. Well, there's a little bit of dissent here, huh? Not everyone's of the same mind. C was 55%. Well, let's go to the answer here, ladies and gentlemen, 70%. 70%. So this is why it's so important that people understand our conservation portfolio of programs at USDA, because investing in those private working lands is of benefit to all of us. And people don't realize that. They think about the parks and the public lands, but really it's so important about the private lands. So let's talk for a moment about where food comes from. I'm hoping that over the course of time in improving our school lunch program, you will see school lunches that look quite like this. But though on my tours around the country, I certainly have seen them look like that. Let's talk about where your food comes from here in Massachusetts. And I know I see my friend Annie here is very involved in Be a Local Hero and CISA. You guys know it all, but let's see what you know. What is the leading commodity in terms of total cash receipts in Massachusetts? Greenhouse, nursery, cranberries, grapes, or corn? Okay, let's call it that. Let's see what you have for me. A by quite a bit, with corn coming on second. Okay, greenhouse, nursery. You're right. But you know, USDA has this great tool. When you go to our website, the National Ag Statistics Service, you can look up all kinds of statistics about your state agriculture. And sometimes you want to buy local. I mean, I went to my local grocery store. They had this big, beautiful display in Washington, D.C., locally grown. And I was like, I know the seasons. And I was like, I don't really think so. And I looked at these strawberries, and they were from California. Washington, D.C., California, not local. I had to go see the manager of the store, of course. It wasn't pretty. Anyhow, but knowing where your food comes from helps you participate in the local food movement. One of the things also that would be very interesting to many of you is on USDA's website, we have what we call the Food Environment Atlas. So you can go into your hometown area in your state and find out different features about your food system, including where potentially there are food deserts, places where there's lack of access to good quality food, where your farmers markets are, and a whole variety of things. So I'm talking about building local regional food system, but one thing I always want to do when I go and talk to people is celebrate the incredible success story of American agriculture. Today in America, one farmer feeds 155 people. No, that's an aggregate, it's an average, but we are highly productive. And while we change things, we won't want to lose sight of that success in doing things. So let me ask you this. How many pounds of beef will a typical steer produce? Okay, let's see what you have for me. Oh, well, there's a little mixed mind here with C having the majority. C had it. So one of the things when you're building a local regional food system too, and I was just at the Brattleboro Co-op this morning, is we have to figure about all the different uses of the steer. There is more than 775 pounds on this steer that's usable meat. So it's about recipes, it's about distribution, it's about processing. There are a lot of things that go into it. And we're trying to figure these things out because this is the Economic Research Service of USDA redoes this slide, this graphic on an annual basis. It's a really important one. This is your food dollar. This is a dollar that you go in and spend at retail. And what this shows is that 15.8 cents is the farm share. The rest of this is distribution and marketing and advertising and all of the rest of the processing. And so part of what we're trying to do in this local regional food system, and we've got to do a whole lot in processing and slaughtering and all that, but also how do we get more of this part of the dollar to the farmer? Because we need our farms to be viable. Not just here in Western Mass, but everywhere. So here's another question. You guys are a big dairy area. This shouldn't be hard. How much does a milking parlor with 16 stalls cost? Basically, one that you would use for 16 cows. 100,000, 150,000, 200,000, 300,000. Okay, let's see what you have for me. Well, C and D are pretty close. There you go, 300,000. So, I got it right. Yeah, good. So here's why I put this out there, is that we have a lot of young people who are interested in going into American agriculture, and the truth is the capital costs of going into agriculture are really high. You know, average combine costs about 250 grand. And so we have to find new tools to help people get into agriculture. Even people who are inheriting the family farm, so to speak, have huge capital challenges. How do we make this work? We've had an epic year for disaster. I just spent yesterday going to the southern rim of Vermont, meeting with farmers who have really been torn apart by Irene. Though it wasn't a disaster tour, it was a resilience tour, because they are into it. They're rebuilding, the communities come together. Actually, I was incredibly joyful by what I saw in terms of community. I was in Wilmington, and there was this poster on the storefront, and it was a boot with the plant coming out of it. It said, courage. And I saw another poster that said, not hell or high water is going to keep us from opening. I met with farmers who said people just came out of the woodwork, people from town, people from other farms, helping them remove debris from their farms. But my point is, you've got the capital costs getting into farming, and then you've got the vagaries of the weather. Drought, farmers in Texas, that is just unbelievably historic drought. We've had freezes up in the Dakotas, we've had tornadoes, so farmers deal with a lot. And that's why we're really pushing some direct marketing, because direct marketing can pay off. This is one recent study that our Economic Research Service did, and they're just looking at a few different products. What this basically shows is that if you're doing direct sales, the farmer's saving more money, and so too with intermediate sales. And we know this is important because we're seeing an out-migration in rural America. Our rural communities are just bleeding people. When you look at the census, the US census, and the last one just came out recently, again, more people leaving rural America. That also means fewer people in Congress coming from rural districts, again, who connect and understand with agriculture. Tough. And many farms are surviving because of off-farm income. And so if sidewalk is rolled up on Main Street and there's no place to shop, get a job, there's no people's pint to go to off hours, you know what I'm saying? There's no vitality to that community, so young people are graduating from college looking for a teaching job, don't want to move to your town. You can't get healthcare providers there because it just doesn't seem like the great place to live. And the kids who've gone to college from the farm don't really want to go back because it doesn't seem like the right place to raise a family. This is a serious problem across the country. And we are trying to reinvest in rural America and understand that it's not just how people are doing in the farm and ranch, but when we talk about the farm safety net, we really need to talk about all of rural America and undergirding it. We talk a lot about the disappearing middle in American agriculture, and this may not be the most recent numbers, but essentially we have an uptick and some solid performance by the really small farms. A lot of them organic, a lot of them alternative, a lot of them direct marketing. And we have in America very viable, very strong big farms. It's the guys in the middle that are getting crunched, particularly the guys that are going from, you know, 100 grand to 500 grand, 600 grand. They're having a hard time making ends meet. And this is just a graphic that, again, shows it's not just out-migration from rural America, but it's the farm population, too. There we go. I mentioned the aging of farmers. Now 59, 58 years of age, 30% of farmers in this country are over the age of 65. I go around the countryside, I meet a lot of farmers who are in their 80s. They didn't plan on farming when they were in their 80s, gang. They don't know who to leave that farm to. They feel very committed to the land, to that lifestyle, to their animals, for example, if they're a dairy farmer. But but there's not a clear pathway forward. And so we need to find a way to incent young people to come into American agriculture. Here's an example of the tree and leaf farm that I mentioned earlier, that young couple that now have their kids on the land. Farmers markets, booming, booming. We just revised our count that was 7,000 some odd this year. Now it's over 8,000. It's a terrible undercount. The farmers market near my home is not in USDA's official count, but it's incredible what's going on. And CSAs, well, the birth of the CSA movement in this country was in Western Massachusetts, but the community-supported agriculture movement is taking off across the land. Food hubs, big area of USDA investment. How do we find places where people can aggregate product? You're a small guy, you're not gonna attract institutional buyers, you don't have the volume. And how are we going to get some light processing done? You don't have you can't afford the equipment. We need food hubs, little regional areas that are close to good distribution channels where that food is aggregated, lightly processed. People join into cooperatives and get that food out to institutional buyers. We have a whole food hub website at USDA, a whole team. This happens to be a group that's up in Portland, Oregon, foodhub.org, where you can find what's going on with that movement nationally. We really like food with a story. People are craving food with a story. Up here on the left is a baseball card. I don't know if you have them around here. I see a couple of heads shaking. So I've seen these around the country. I think they're popular in Rhode Island right now. Kids, instead of trading baseball cards, or in addition to trading baseball cards, instead of Tim Lincecum or I'm not even talking about that other team that's local. I mean, going to the 14th inning, that was a good night, but the rest of it I'm not talking about. So instead of the baseball player on the baseball card, it's the farmer and the farmer's stats, and kids trade them in the classroom, in the lunchroom. I went to one school lunchroom in Oklahoma where the farmers come in on a regular basis, eat with the kids in the classroom. And they have a very active Ag in the Classroom program. And I started to try to do the iClicker thing with them, not with these, but just sort of ask them about Oklahoma agriculture. Well, pretty soon, after they got all the answers right, they turned it around and started asking me questions. How to get out of town really quickly. It was really, really inspirational. And in my own research at Tufts with some of my doctoral students, what we found is that kids are engaged in garden-based learning and they're connecting with agriculture. They tend to do better on scientific literacy, that whole plant science thing in the early grades, their willingness to try and actually consume fruits and vegetables increases. That exposure, really important. Shepherd's grain. Now, I've been talking a lot about local and regional, but in terms of fruits and vegetables, I tend to do that sometimes. But also commodity growers are really into this. Shepherd's grain is a farmers cooperative in a three-state area, Oregon, Washington State, and I think Idaho. And they weren't making money. And they said, you know what, we're going to rethink our entire business model. We're going to brand ourselves. We're going to have a food with a story, and we're going to try to let people know exactly where that food comes from. They've been phenomenally successful. They do this specialty baking wheat flour, and you can actually scan the product in the marketplace and find out what farm it came from. North Carolina is doing something really interesting. They have a 10% campaign. Their university is really involved in this, and they're trying to get every individual in the state and every institution to spend 10% local. And they're trying to collect all the data to see what it means for their economy, right? So you're not just spending a dollar at the grocery store, you're spending that dollar at the grocery store that stays in your community and you keep that money local. They're trying to see what that means. A lot of states are very interested in branding. Are those kids cute? Alaskan grown. That probably has nothing to do with food, but they're so cute I had to put them in. But you see, a lot of states are really interested in this sort of process. Now, interestingly, a lot of the big guys are getting into local. You have even Walmart. There was a late night show. What is one of these late night shows that Simcoe that I can't stay up for? Who would it be? Stewart, Letterman. Letterman, I can't stay up for, I'm in bed by 10, who am I kidding? So, yeah. And so John Stewart had on the vice president of Walmart about a week after he had my boss, Tom Vilsack, the secretary of agriculture, on. Tom Vilsack presented him a likeness of him and a bust in cheddar cheese. Organic Valley, organic cheddar cheese. Anyhow, but it was a good little gig. He did fine. But the next week, he's got the VP of Walmart on, and he says to the VP, he's like, I don't know if I should say this, but you're kind of more powerful than the Secretary of Agriculture, aren't you? And they kind of laugh, but, you know, kind of, yeah. I mean, Walmart's a giant. So however you think about them and what this is a very significant adventure that they're on. And we all should be engaging and watching and thinking about that. Oh, there he is. Is that John Stewart? Who is that? Oh, he's the Colbert Report. See, I don't even know. I'm not hip enough to know. There's the cheddar cheese head. Whew. Okay, a little bit about USDA, if you don't mind. Tell me, we just heard about USDA's budget. What do you think I spend the most money on at USDA? A, nutrition assistance, B, farm subsidies, C, conservation, or D, food safety? Do 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 do. Oh, well, we have a lot of mixed feelings here. A, B, C, not so much, and D. Let's see what we have. Wow. I don't remember which was the big winner there. Let me see if I can go back. Can I go back? B was farm subsidies. Okay. Here's the truth of the matter. I've been all over this country talking to college students. It doesn't matter if I'm at some four-year elite institution, Stanford University. It doesn't matter if I'm at a big land-grant university, Iowa State. It doesn't matter if I'm at Greenfield Community College in my hometown. Everyone picks farm subsidies. Truth of the matter is that's a very small slice of what we do. 74% nutrition assistance. Yeah, I'm seeing some confused faces. I got a PR problem in my job, don't I? People don't get that. So all this budget cutting that you're hearing about in terms of how we're going to fix the budget deficit, I hear people say we're going to cut Medicare and Social Security and farm subsidies, and that'll do it. I'm like, you think? Like, I don't think they really know how little money is actually going into farm subsidies. So given that, I've told you, the SNAP program, the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, formerly known as food stamps, how many Americans receive SNAP benefits? 1 in 3, 1 in 7, 1 in 12, 1 in 20. So we have, a divide again. B has it by a little bit, 1 in 7. It's actually, the right answer to the ones I gave you is 1 in 7. It's closer to 1 in 6 now. It's over 45 million people. So that is really a large part of the work of USDA. So when I was appointed the Deputy Secretary of Agriculture, not typical for someone in my position to come from Massachusetts or a background having done a lot in organic and sustainable agriculture. But when I put out that pie chart and I said, you know, my last job, I was on the faculty of the Truff School of Nutrition Policy and Nutrition Science and Policy, and 74% of our money is nutrition assistance, so maybe I actually do fit. We're dealing with obesity in this country. There has been no better messenger than Michelle Obama. I love working with her. She's a hugger, by the way. First time I met her, she gave me one of those big bear hugs. I'm like, what are you doing? It's the first lady, you know? So anyhow, she's a lot of fun, and she's got this whole Let's Move initiative, and she's really challenged USDA and all of the federal family to do more because it's a real challenge. And I put up here a nutrition paradox. I have a former student, at least one, in the audience. I always talked about policy paradox. And people say, well, Kathleen, how can you have both hunger in America, 18 million kids, actually, food insecure at some point in their year, and obesity? How can you have the same things? Doesn't make any sense. Well, the truth of the matter is it's the same root cause, lack of access to good quality food. You've probably seen this map. I don't even know if Colorado's still blue, but there's this unbelievable information on the Centers for Disease Control, CDC's website, where you can watch the acceleration of obesity rates in this country over time. They have a time series. It's really quite gripping, but it's a real big problem. So tell me, what is the predicted rate of type 2 diabetes for children born after the year 2000. Wow, 68. 34 have it, B, 1 in 3, and that is absolutely correct. Ouch, right? If trends don't change. So this is really, really serious. Now, some of you may have seen that USDA has come out with a new food icon. It's called myplate.gov. So the food guide pyramid, it's not gone away. It's just sort of shuffled to the side. We found that a lot of people we found it too complicated. It wasn't really that informative. And we needed something simpler to really get people to think about what they eat. And one of the things that this MyPlate is trying to do is let people know that really half of their plate should be fruits and vegetables. Now, you know, that just goes against our whole culture, right? You know, you go to a party, a potluck, I'm going to be cooking the roast or whatever. You bring a side. Like the fruits and vegetables, they're kind of a side. They're not a main event in the meal. We got a whole national challenge here to rethink how we do food. And one of the things that I say when we talk about this local regional agriculture, the Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food initiative, is that if tomorrow all Americans started to adhere to these new dietary guidelines and ate half a plate of fruit and vegetables, a whole heck of a lot of it would be imported because we don't produce enough. That's an opportunity for the American farmer. And one of the things that I like to do is myth busting. I have kids and they like that show on PBS. And one of the things I hear at the very highest levels is if we start putting more fruits and vegetables in the school meals, if we start eating more fruits and vegetables ourselves, it's just going to be much more expensive. And I challenge that notion. And I challenge it based on scientific study that USDA has done. There was a great piece in the New York Times this weekend that took that very line of thought, that processed food and some of the food, it's not less expensive. You can eat a healthy diet. You can eat the amount of fruits and vegetables you need to do economically. But food deserts is a problem. We have a lot of people. Food deserts, by USDA's definition, is you have an area largely low income, where they have more than a mile to go to a grocery and no public transportation. They're buying their foods from corner stores, sometimes liquor stores, and actually they're paying more money for lesser quality food. And so the First Lady is really taken on this issue by storm, trying to get us all to find ways to deal with food deserts. One of our strategies at USDA is going mobile. You know, I know from rural communities, we're growing up in this part of the world. I mean, who's gonna cite a grocery store in Heath or Holly? I don't know how many people know where those places are, but I do. You need a certain population threshold to sustain a brick and mortar grocery. It's not gonna make sense for everywhere. But maybe in some cases, we can put the grocery store on wheels and get to the communities of need. That's one of the things that we've been thinking about. Farm to school. This is really something that we connect with. And I just met this day at lunch with some of the people in your community. They're doing some really innovative stuff. Farm institution, farm to school. I think this region, despite your weather, your growing season, the school year, it's not a perfect match. But I think you've got the people. You've got the people who really want to make this happen. And I've had a series of meetings with the regional state secretaries of agriculture who really want to make this happen. I think it's a real win. We're really looking at methane digesters, too, as another way for farmers to capture additional income. But we need the help of the utility companies to make that work. And we're looking at value-added investments for farmers. So this is a little company, Cowpots. You may have seen it. This was on Letterman. I know this was on Letterman, another show I didn't see because I'm asleep. But where they use some of their manure-based product to develop a container to grow plants. How do we help farmers do value-added? And we're also looking at urban agriculture. We think that there's a lot of opportunity on small pieces of land for people to really not just grow their own food, but become food entrepreneurs. So lastly, since I'm here at a college, I'm just gonna plead for particularly young people in the audience to get involved, to care about this issue. And there are a lot of ways to get involved at USDA. We are on a downward sloping budget right now, but in the next couple of years, I imagine a lot of jobs again are going to open up at USDA. We're also seeing historic retirement rates. When I started this job, 50% of our employees, fifth largest employer in the federal government, 50% of our employees were retirement eligible. The downtick in the economy prevented a lot of people from retiring, but they're starting to think about it. And so there are going to be jobs in the future for you at USDA. And there's not a job kind of thing that you do that we don't do at USDA. Do you know that USDA has people in 99 different countries? Where most of the embassies, there's an ag attaché. You like foreign languages. You like to see the world. You're an economist. We have economists. We have nutritionists. We have lawyers. My husband's one. You know the expression, first kill all the lawyers. We have journalists. I always have to do a lawyer joke for his sake. You have scientists. We have community organizers. We have bankers. You name the job, we probably have that at USDA, so I want you to consider it. Well, I already gave you the answer to this, what percentage of our employees are retirement eligible. If you couldn't get that right, I assume that you got that, 50%.
Hi, I'm Michelle Bucci. I'm a special assistant. I have master's degrees in economics and public health, and I went to work at the Food and Nutrition Service because every day I get to help feed America's hungry children.
I'm Aaron Morris with USDA Rural Development. I'm a former FFA member with a degree in agricultural business. Every day I get to assist rural communities, construct hospitals, schools, and libraries, and other essential community facilities to help improve the quality of life of rural Americans.
I'm Stephen Mirsky with the Sustainable Agricultural Systems Laboratory. My PhD is in agronomy, and what I find most exciting about my job is working in multidisciplinary teams to improve the sustainability of agriculture and have direct impact on our food systems.
Mi nombre es Nicolás Rubio, economista de Servicio Extranjero Agrícola. Tengo una maestría en estudios latinoamericanos. Y lo que más me gusta en mi trabajo es trabajar con nuestras oficinas en el exterior para encontrar oportunidades de exportación para nuestros extranjeros.
Hi, I'm Chuck Lipstrew. I'm a special assistant in the Legislative Affairs Branch of the Farm Service Agency. I love politics, and every day I come to work and help members of Congress and their staffs understand what our leaders at USDA are doing to help farmers and ranchers across the country.
I'm Caitlin Guzman Hartman. I work in the Farm and Foreign Agricultural Services. I have a background in community organizing, and what I love about my job is I get to work with the agency that has 2,300 county offices across our nation and serving producers on the ground.
We're USDA. Every day, every way.
So that was a cute little video some of the younger folk in my office did for me to show you that we're not all over the age of 50. Many of us are. So if you're interested in opportunities at USDA, you might want to start with an internship. But also look at usajobs.gov as a possibility for work. And again, I mentioned that we have this huge transition on our working lands. I would love young people to consider farming and ranching a career. We can connect you. It's a really exciting thing. And that is the end of the slideshow. I guess I had one thing. So that's it. I thank you for your very kind attention and happy to answer any questions.